Last month, we exclusively revealed how the return of Sam Fisher will bring about a revolution in the stealth genre. Pandora Tomorrow will scrape away many of the painful inflammations that have formed on the bottom of the original Splinter Cell, offering crisper graphics, a more dramatic orchestral score, and a more dynamic plotline. But it's still very much a hardcore stealth game, even if the developers seem fit to inject a number of action set pieces more in keeping with the Metal Gear Solid series. Latest dose of hardcore bondage, Electronic Arts have not only signed up the aging likeness of Pierce Brosnan, they've also grabbed themselves the cute mistress of hip-hop, Maya. She performs the theme tune to this stunning opening sequence, and also appears alongside the suave 007 as the sultry Bond girl Maya Starling. What is love without a flame? What's a rose without a name? What is pleasure without pain? It ain't nothing more than an empty space. The previous two Bond outings were first-person shooters, where you saw all the action directly through Bond's eyes. Everything or Nothing, on the other hand, is viewed from the third person, meaning you now follow Bond from an external camera, in the same way you do with Sam Fisher in Splinter Cell, making everything a ton more cinematic in the process. This is especially evident when Shannon Elizabeth or Heidi Klum make an appearance and get fully debriefed by the most sexually rampant secret agent on the planet. Of course, this timely switch in perspective has a fundamental impact on the style of play too, adding heaps of strategy to the action that didn't previously exist.
Sorry, gentlemen. I'm a train catch.
And from time to time, Bond continues his pursuit of evil henchmen in a range of vehicles, including cars, tanks, motorbikes and helicopters. Jaws even makes an appearance too, and there's more than just a few glorious explosions. Easily the biggest 007 title yet.
Now, here's something for your next mission that I'm particularly proud of, 007. You're not afraid of spiders, are you?
Hyper Street Fighter 2 provides a pick and mix of every character from five versions of the classic arcade series. This isn't a compilation of all five games, just all the fighters and their individual incarnations from title to title. The fascination of this game is that it allows you to face off characters from different versions of the Street Fighter franchise and see how they compete in one arena. Of course, this does mean that fighters from the later games do have an instant advantage. Characters that hail from the Super Turbo Edition are simply better than those in any other version, with their exclusive chargeable super meter that allows for devastating special attacks. But it's not all a foregone conclusion. Capcom has included a number of surprises in the way that the characters interact, so the old-timers might well have the last laugh yet. But for all of Hyper Street Fighter 2's rekindling of nostalgia, there are simply far better beat-em-ups available on PS2. A game like this simply cannot compare to the majesty of Virtua Fighter 4 Evolution. If you're already a Street Fighter fan, this review will fall on deaf ears, while those who missed out on the series' heyday might well wonder what all the fuss was about.
Yeah!
Like all urbanised street-level sports variants, urban freestyle soccer takes place in gritty, graffiti-strewn city-based environments, with individual gangs vying for control of each other's turf through intense and aggressive street soccer challenges. Plenty of OTT moves, combos and supercharged netbuster power-up tricks are at your disposal once you've mastered the tricky control system.
Make it count! Chase back!
Stick with it and soon you'll breeze past every computer opponent that comes your way. And the multiplayer side of things will ensure more fiercely competitive match play.
Get in there. Watch your back.
The Ridge Racer games were all about mad, embarrassingly simple arcade racing. But now the new Ridge Racer has gone for a marginally more grown-up approach. It's far from being a completely serious sim, and still parades its noble heritage, but it's lost a lot of the arcade flashiness we used to love about the series. Once you've adapted to the change in handling, you'll need to concentrate on winning a race or two. Luckily, the game gives you the ability to freak out the other drivers, exposing them as the anxious and accident-prone AI opponents they really are. It's a nice idea. Follow a car long enough and a meter will appear, slowly filling up to flashing point when your rival's stress levels are high enough. This can lead to the computer opponent spinning out or losing his place in some other comedic fashion. It's fun, but not really as much fun as, well, just passing them, really. The game also boasts 14 tracks, some taken from real life and others culled from the minds of its creators. But where even the PS1 Ridge Racers featured stunning scenery and improbable courses set through all manner of cities, temples and forests, our racing has chosen a more sedate style. The most exciting it gets is when you rally through a desert course or spot windmills turning slowly as you execute another power slide. Although it's sturdy and playable, it doesn't quite match the majesty of the Gran Turismo games. R-Racing not only does nothing new, but it successfully manages to get rid of most of what was fun about the Ridge Racer experience in the first place. Less cars, less flashy, and crucially lacking the perfect looks and outrageous handling the series is famous for.
Destiny.
Final Fantasy X2 isn't so much a sequel as a spin-off. It's a continuation of the story from Final Fantasy X, to be precise, set 2 years on. As such, it's the first Final Fantasy game that doesn't have to reinvent itself from scratch with a new world. But like we say, although it continues the timeline, it's not so much a direct sequel, and more an exploration of the slightly zany adventures of girly characters Yuna and Riku from the first game. As far as gameplay goes, not a lot's changed. You explore new areas to complete quests, all the while being interrupted with random, unavoidable monster encounters that take the form of turn-based battles. But X2 has at least been injected with a new sense of urgency, thanks to battles that mostly take place in real time. You only have a few seconds to decide what to do before the monsters wade in, and being quick with your commands means your character will be able to pack in more hits before the enemy takes his turn. Ultimately, this game does look pretty spectacular, but it's nothing new in the world of adventuring, and on top of that, we're fairly sure that only diehard fans will stick with it all the way. After a couple of botched 3D attempts on the Nintendo 64, we firmly believe that Castlevania should never have made the leap beyond two dimensions. But shorn of its role-playing and platform jumping elements, Konami's latest 3D solution is the standard third-person perspective Devil May Cry-ish action game. Being a prequel to the backstory is kept mercifully brief, and so it's not long before your vampire hunter character, Leon Belmont, is entering the head of Bloodsucker's castle, whip in hand to help him rescue his kidnapped fiancée. Five themed levels filled with hundreds of rooms are there for the taking before the final showdown. And just so you don't get too stuck, the quintet of levels can be explored in any order. Stick with it and you'll have no problem finishing the game in around 10 hours. And once you work out Castlevania's system of hitting switches, collecting hearts to power sub-weapons and dodging the undead, the game doesn't really seem so big after all. A good effort overall, but gamers really deserve more value for money. Nightshade isn't a direct sequel to last year's Shinobi, but rather a side story, albeit one involving the usual demons attacking the usual Tokyo-based settings. Even the basic gameplay remains pretty much the same, that being to wade your way through a whole series of bad guys before taking on some unspeakable boss horror at the end of the level. New Ninja Ebana is more than capable of performing all the required ninja party tricks, including jumping very high, throwing shuriken, and doing that really cool thing where they move so fast a little shadow of them is left hovering frozen in midair while they kick enemy ass. So, overall, it's like Shinobi then. Well, that's not entirely fair. Shinobi was a fresh new game. Here there's been the time available to improve the graphics, control and camera system, but that doesn't seem to have happened. So, unless you love ninjas very, very much, we can't strongly recommend this one.
Is still good.
I only did the obvious. It was no longer of use to me.
Oh, you'll pay for this. If you weren't here.
You are weak.
Why, Jimushi? Why?
Originally an 80s arcade racer, the PS2 update of Spy Hunter 2 could well turn out to be a huge success. Especially now a film starring WWE hero The Rock has been announced, flogging the classic franchise to a whole new generation of gamers. The mix of guns, cars and secret gadgets appear like a space age version of James Bond. Lasers replace bullets, and a shiny multitasking assault vehicle ousts the already rusty-looking Aston Martin Vanquish from the 007 flick Die Another Day. Your missions vary, of course. One minute you're required to safely escort politicians, the next you're escaping hostile zones and blowing the hell out of practically every motorist you see. It's slick, fast and looks great, but from what we've seen so far, it does seem to be quite short-lived. We'll let you know whether it's good for more than 30 minutes of loud, violent fun next month.
You kept a lady waiting.
If you like your puzzle games simple and gloriously addictive, check out Sega's Tetris-style puzzler, Puyo Pop Fever. Here's how it works. Odd-shaped coloured bubbles with eyes descend into the gaming pit one at a time. Match them up with three other pieces of the same colour to create a chain, and they'll disappear. Do this consistently and rocks plop down onto your rival's half of the screen, making it harder for them to match up their share of the bubbles. Careful tactical play annoys the hell out of whoever you're playing against, as you rack up loads of rival-destroying rocks by pulling off gigantic, intricately planned combos. And while multiplayer mode is great fun for competitive friends, you can still play away happily against the implacable computer characters with a range of single-player options. So, is it as good as Tetris then? Well, not really, but only because there's no puzzle game that's ever quite surpassed the Russian master's fearsome level of playability. As these things go, we reckon Puyo Pop Fever is about as close as you can get to Tetris's lofty ideals of puzzle perfection, but falls just a little short. Sonic the Hedgehog finally arrives on PS2, and we're crying with joy at his long overdue return. Just about every notable Sonic star from years gone by is present, 12 in all split into four teams of three, Team Sonic, Dark, Rose and Chaotix. You control one group of three throughout the entire adventure, and switching between characters changes the formation of your on-screen heroes. It all happens at the press of a button, and is completely genius in operation. Each team member has a specialist area. Select Speed King Sonic, for example, and the two other characters line up behind him for maximum straight-line speed. Switch to Hardman Knuckles for a three-abreast block-smashing powerhouse. And finally, there's Tails. Select him and both Sonic and Knuckles grab his feet as you helicopter away to previously unreachable locations. Of course, just about everything is performed at breakneck speed. And this is definitely Sonic's fastest adventure yet. You must have played a Sonic the Hedgehog game at least once in your life. And while Heroes looks a bit like the Dreamcast Sonic Adventure, there's little in the way of dodgy camera work or graphical glitching to spoil things. Instead, it plays in the streamlined, intuitive race style of the old Mega Drive games, but with a three-way tactical element that adds loads of possibilities and longevity to its levels. Whereas snooker requires an entire lifetime of relentless practice to become remotely competent, anyone with basic motor neurone functions and a long wooden stick can pot a pool ball, even after 11 pints of strong continental lager.
This is a pretty tough little shot here.
Welcome one and all to
the sunny Las Vegas Nevada. Today hands us in this amazing movie.
World Championship Pool 2004 is undeniably good, offering many variations of the game. There's 9-ball, 8-ball and straight pool, which is an American variant where you sink any ball in any combination for single point scoring. There's also traditional snooker, and a whole series of 33 trick shots that you can unlock, plus bonus games which are just enjoyable little variations on 8-ball. Anyone familiar with World Championship Snooker 2003 will be able to pick this up immediately. But whether it's a viable alternative to the Boozer still remains to be seen.
managed to infiltrate a cell run by Anna Espinoza.
Anna?
Our source, Agent Jacobs, informed us that Anna has been working on something referred to only as the machine. Before being compromised, he made a successful dead drop inside Anna's current location, the Monte Carlo casino operated by Sark from one of his mansions.
You're saying Sark and Anna are working together?
That's what you need to find out. You and Dixon will be infiltrating the casino. You've already established your alias as a new waitress.
And I'll be posing as a player on the casino floor. Since your uniform doesn't exactly have pockets, I'll smuggle in Marshall's optech for you. After you make contact with me, we can stay in audiovisual contact via your PDA.
There's two things you have to do in the casino. If you get too close to Sark, he'll recognize you. But we can tag his driver. Drop a traceable radioactive serum into the driver's drink. That will allow us to track his movements.
Once you do that, you'll recover Jacob's dead drop. He stored his intel on disk and hid it in a secure location inside the casino. Hopefully, it'll tell us more about the machine.
We've got Bristow cornered. Do you want us to bring her in?
Boy. you, sir. The situation is bad. The Hellcast have broken through the perimeter. We're trying to contain them.
Yeah, come on.
Resident Evil Outbreak was originally touted as the first multiplayer online entry for the franchise, but at this time it's still unconfirmed as to whether the European version of the game allows for internet gameplay. Luckily, what we've seen so far still looks like being a classic entry in the Resident Evil series. Taking the role of one of 8 zombie-making biovirus-infected citizens of Raccoon City, the basic idea is to get the hell out of Dodge before your vocabulary is reduced to continually mumbling the word brains. The fact that you're no longer alone is obviously the biggest change from previous Resident Evil games, and it's up to you how you treat the accompanying characters. If you're clever, you'll enlist their help and swap items with them, do them favors, and fight with them against the endless encroaching menace of the terrifying zombies. Generally, if you're attacked, they'll help you out if they can, shooting or hitting zombies that are attacking you. But you'd better be prepared to do the same for them, because if you don't, they'll surely die. And without friends around, escaping is going to prove well nigh impossible. As if keeping other characters sweet wasn't enough, you have to keep a beady eye on your virus, and it'll rise a little. Get attacked by the undead a whole lot, and suddenly your meter is permanently on the rise. The only thing that'll stop it is the T-virus antidote, and it's hard to find. By the time you find some, you may well be inching yourself agonizingly across the floor. And if your virus count rises to 100%, in the online game you become one of the zombies yourself. We cannot guarantee your safety. Quite simply, you've never seen a Resident Evil game look this good before. Every background looks hand-drawn, or even photographic in its perfection, until the perspective changes and you realize that PS2 is drawing it all itself in 3D. Much of the story is still told in the form of amazing cutscenes, starting with what happened the first night that the evil Umbrella Corporation unleashed the T-virus on the unsuspecting town. But the rest is composed of stunning graphics that'll keep you exploring whether you're being pursued by the undead or not. The game is finally out in Japan, and literally thousands of Japanese people are sitting in front of their PS2s linked up together over the internet, playing as survivors of a zombie apocalypse. But even if the whole 4-player online aspect doesn't make it over here, Outbreak is still looking as terrifying, gory, and indeed as frustrating as ever. Admit it, you wouldn't want it any other way.
Your man, Nick Scryer. Facial reconstruction and a memory wipe.
Intelligence has the movement attacking the refinery in about 90 hours.
This memory wipe will give us plenty of time to drop him in and get him past the movement psi probes. Mindgate's specialty is psyops. They dismissed General Krieger, but Scryer stayed with Mindgate and took his psychic powers to a new level.
We'll be right back. This is no threat.
Thank you.
In the beginning, there was only darkness. Then light shone in the void, and a new world was born. A realm forged from the elemental forces of earth, wind, water, and fire. The nexus of an eternal war waged between the forces of light and darkness. Between chaos and order, which destroy the world in a mighty cataclysm. Unto this broken realm came the overlords. Beautiful Aina, goddess of the waters. The steadfast purity of crashing waves and thundering waterfalls.